Today we're going to talk about some of the occlusal concepts that we might use in our clinic. Some of this material is provided by UCLA, the American College of Prosthodontists, and the Avoclair Vivadent Corporation. Much thanks to them. There are several differences between natural and complete denture occlusion. With natural dentition, you have the retained periodontal ligaments around all of the teeth, which provide an amazing amount of proprioceptive powers, whereas in the complete denture, the total surface area of the mucosa under the denture base is all that we have from a standpoint of proprioception. So quite different from natural dentition. In the natural dentition, the units move independently, whereas the teeth move as a unit with the complete denture. One thing affects all of the teeth. The malocclusion effects are not necessarily immediate with natural dentition because of the fact that those teeth are embedded in bone, whereas malocclusion affects the entire denture base immediately by causing soreness on the ridges. Any non-vertical forces on the natural teeth are usually pretty well tolerated, whereas any kind of non-vertical forces against the denture teeth is very traumatic to the underlying tissues. Incising doesn't affect the posteriors in natural dentition, whereas if you incise on complete denture dentition, it's going to affect the denture base everywhere, and especially in that posterior area also. Where you have natural dentition, you rarely have bilateral balance, meaning that all of the teeth contact in all of the excursive motions. Whereas in denture dentition, it is often desired for base stability, for there to be contact in all the eccentric movements on the denture teeth. Tactile sensitivity is much greater with natural dentition than with the foreign or denture dentition. The overall goal that we have when we establish some type of complete denture occlusion is to minimize the trauma to the supporting tissues. We want to preserve those remaining structures, and the way we have to do that is having occlusion that is as least traumatic to the underlying surface as possible. We need to enhance the stability of the dentures. We don't have a problem with natural dentition because those teeth are all embedded into the bone and we have natural stability. We're not so with complete dentures. We want to also facilitate the aesthetics and speech by proper placement of the teeth in the arches, and we'd like to restore masticatory efficiency to a reasonable level, even though that efficiency with complete dentures is only about 50% of what you would get with natural dentition, if that much. There are basically two types of complete denture occlusion: bilateral balance and neutrocentric occlusion. We prefer the bilateral balance because this type of an occlusal arrangement or scheme helps or limits tipping of the dentures during parafunctional activities when you're going into different movements of the mandible. By bilateral balance in denture occlusion, we mean that there is a stable simultaneous contact of the opposing upper and lower teeth in centric relation position with a smooth bilateral gliding contact to any eccentric position within the normal range of mandibular function. It's developed to limit the tipping or rotation of the denture bases in relation to the supporting structures during function. Traditionally, bilateral balance was achieved with anatomic posterior teeth. However, it can be achieved with non-anatomic teeth using balancing ramps or by manipulating the compensating curve when we develop the occlusion in the complete dentures. If you look at these pictures closely, you will see that on the bottom right picture, when the patient is in centric relation, you have bilateral posterior contact. all of those lingual cusps are in the central fossas, are in the fossas of the mandibular teeth. So you have centralized forces down the ridge simultaneously all the way around. In working, when the patient goes into working, all of those buccal cusps in the far right picture up above, you will see that those teeth are still in contact in working. Whereas on the opposite side, in balancing, you will also see that those lingual cusps are riding up the inner inclines of the buccal cusps and still remaining in contact. Also in protrusive, because of all of that contact in protrusive, even those posterior molars touching in protrusive, minimizes the tipping that a denture will do. So this is very good for stability to have this type of an occlusal scheme, but very difficult to set if you're trying to set these teeth. You can achieve bilateral balanced occlusion with our monoplane teeth or our non-anatomic posterior teeth if we use balancing ramps. What happens is it's waxed up and then produced into acrylic, those ramps that are shown on the backs of each of these dentures pictured. What that means is when the patient goes into lateral movement, you have to maintain at least 3-point contact with the posteriors and the anteriors so that the denture does not tip when going into those movements. Same way in protrusive. When you go in protrusive, the anterior teeth would touch and the posterior teeth would touch this balancing ramp that is produced in the posterior area. What you absolutely must have is a protrusive record in order to replicate the angle of the eminence so that this balanced setup can be worked into the occlusal scheme. We can also achieve bilateral balance using our lingualized setups, again utilizing the balancing ramps in order to maintain 3-point contact when the patient goes into lateral movements or protrusive movements. It's achieved the same way if you would incorporate a curve of spi into the denture. You can maintain that contact also. In our clinics, we use the monoplane occlusion with the neutrocentric concept. This concept of occlusion assumes that the anterior-posterior plane of occlusion will be absolutely parallel to the denture foundation area, and it's going to not be dictated by our condylar inclination. We do not take a protrusive record for this. The plane of occlusion is completely flat and level, and there's no curve of spi or curve of Wilson set up in the teeth. Together, those two are called the compensating curve, and they exist only in denture occlusion, and they are not incorporated into our setup. On this, there's no vertical overlap of the anterior teeth for aesthetics. Patient goes into protrusive, those teeth will slide over one another. When using this concept of occlusion, the patient's instructed not to incise the bolus of food coming forward because the posteriors will lift up off of the denture foundation. The patient will become sort of a chopper. He's not going to be a chewer or a grinder. He's just going to chomp his food and not go into any type of movements, just up and down to incise or to cut that food. With monoplane occlusion or the neutrocentric concept, you will notice that all of the teeth when the patient's in centric relation are in contact, and everything should be in contact on that tooth. The lingual cusp, it should be totally flat, and the lingual cusp as well as that middle groove would be in contact with one another. At balancing in protrusive positions, there is separation of the posterior teeth leading to tipping of the dentures when the patient tries to incise food. This is one of the disadvantages in using this type of occlusion. And when the patient has parafunctional grinding habits, This is definitely a disadvantage for the patient. Hanau's Quint is an important ingredient of complete denture education, and there's an entire lecture on Blackboard on Hanau's Quint. You really ought to review it. It's very good, it's very interesting, and it's kind of a review of what you've had in TMD, but it's in relation to complete dentures. There are five factors that affect occlusal balance. They are condylar inclination, incisal guidance, occlusal plane inclination, compensating curve, and cuspal inclination, and we'll talk a little bit about them. Hanau's Quint, with the interrelationship of the five factors that we talked about, can be described by Thielman's formula, which is shown on this page. In order to maintain balanced occlusion, the formula has to be recognized. From Hanau's Quint, there are certain factors that are controlled by the dentist. Of the five factors, the patient presents you with the condylar inclination. That cannot be altered by the dentist. It's what he has is what he has. The occlusal plane cannot really be altered substantially because it has the same functional requirements that dictate its position and orientation. It has to be pretty much level with the denture base foundation. The remaining three factors of incisal guidance, cuspal inclination, and the compensating curve can all be regulated by the dentist. This just shows us that the three items that are under the control of the dentist are the incisal guidance, cuspal inclination, and compensating curve. Sometimes you're tested on these in board questions. Within the confines of aesthetics and phonetics, the rule is that we should minimize incisal guidance in complete dentures to minimize inclined tipping forces. We avoid anterior guidance with complete dentures. Then when we do this, we can adjust the remaining factors to maintain bilateral balance with the dentures. There are several posterior tooth forms that we can use. We can use lingualized teeth, monoplane with the nutricentric concept or monoplane with balancing ramps. We can use lingualized opposing monoplane versus anatomic teeth. We can use semi-anatomic teeth opposing one another and anatomic teeth opposing one another. We have those choices, but we need to know the indications for which to use when. Illustrated on this slide are various tooth forms that we have available. On the lower left, we start out with the teeth with the least amount of cuspal inclination. They're totally flat. They're 0 degree or monoplane teeth on the lower left. Then we can move up to the picture right above that is a representation of semi-anatomical teeth. We have cuspal inclinations, but they're not very steep, and those are classified in the 10 degree, 12 degree range as semi-anatomic teeth. On the far right in the lower left picture, or lower right picture, excuse me, we have lingualized occlusion where we might have a flat plane tooth on the lower or one with slight cuspal inclination with a tooth above it that has a steep cuspal inclination, and it's set though with only the lingual cusp in function. The upper right shows full anatomic representation where we have steep cuspal inclinations. On the upper picture where you have those teeth with silver, these are old schemes that were developed to hopefully they thought be more efficient if there was metal embedded. These are called Hardy cutters on the far right, that zigzag effect, and this was on the left was just an anatomical adaptation with metal on the main occluding cusp of the denture tooth. On this slide, you will see cuspal inclination indicated. Those circled teeth show that the cusp forms with mesial and distal inclines and with steep central fossa occlusion are considered anatomic teeth. Some are semi-anatomic, when there's only a 12 or 10 degree cuspal inclination, all the way up to 40 degree cuspal inclinations that are available to you in denture teeth. The tooth that is circled in the lower portion of the screen shows a completely flat plane tooth. The cusps are totally flat. The manufacturer may put in some central fossa grooves in order to try and make that tooth look more aesthetic, as well as to allow food to travel through the fossa, but by and large, the cuspal inclinations on that teeth, on those teeth, are totally flat. Lastly, we're showing a representation of the semi-anatomical tooth, where we have very slight degrees of cuspal inclination. On the left, you see pretty much about a 10 or 12 degree tooth. On the right is the classic 20 degree tooth that's produced by Dentsply. But again, these are classified as semi-anatomic teeth. The goals that we have when we decide on our complete denture occlusion are that we want to minimize trauma to the supporting structures, we want to preserve the remaining structures, we want to enhance stability as much as possible, we're interested in aesthetic speech and mastication, and we want to enhance mastication. In addition, we would like to decrease the lateral forces on the residual ridges, which causes irritation and discomfort. Here are some general concepts of denture occlusion. Some common features. The functional anatomy is the main determinant of the denture tooth position and the type of occlusion that we select. We want simultaneous bilateral posterior contact in centric relation. We also want centralization of the centric occlusal forces over the mandibular ridges. That's true both buccolingually and anterior posteriorly. One of the questions is balance absolutely necessary? On the left, you can see flat plane occlusion that's been established, and in the protrusive position with a balancing ramp, you do have three-point contact between the second molars and the lower balancing ramp and the anterior teeth. In the protrusive position with flat plane teeth, with non-balanced occlusion, you have an opening in the posterior as the patient comes forward to occlude on the incisors. So do we really need to have this balance is the question. The question of whether balance is necessary comes into play when a patient puts a bolus of food in his mouth and starts to bite on it on one side of the arch. When he opens and places that bolus of food, the teeth on the other side are not in contact at that point. When he bites down, the left side of the denture on the lower flips up until it is in contact with the teeth on the upper arch, creating a balance that is damaging to the ridge. Forces are exerted on the residual ridge in the areas shown by the yellow areas on the slide. I like this saying on this slide. Society is made up of happy neurotics, unhappy neurotics, and a few psychotics, and some of each of them become partially or totally edentulous. This is a saying by the dentist shown on the slide. What it boils down to is that balance is for parafunctional activity when the teeth are totally together and the person is moving from side to side or anteriorly, to maintain contact with all of the parts of the denture and cause little damage to the underlying surfaces. In a study that was determining whether balance or non-balance made a difference, it was found that no patients really had a preference of one over the other, that the balanced were maybe slightly more efficient as far as mastication went, but the percentage of patients using eccentric movements during mastication is actually very small. In another study of denture occlusion, this one particularly advocates the use of cuspless teeth, primarily because they're easy to use for the dentist. They also cannot prove that balanced occlusion is absolutely necessary for the patient. In my own personal history, if a patient has been used to cusped teeth, they do not like the flat plain teeth on their dentures if they have had cusped teeth. They indicate or they've said statements like, I feel like I have two boards that I'm just using to eat my food with and I'm just trying to mash it. In establishing a monoplane occlusion with balance, the occlusal plane is established parallel to the foundation and the height is approximately half the distance between the ridges. It runs horizontally and intersects a point approximately half the way up retromolar pad. The teeth do not extend posteriorly past the point where the ridge makes a dramatic turn upward. The balancing ramp is established posterior to the teeth and is developed to work in harmony with the angle of condylar guidance. This is established by taking a protrusive record on the patient. The occlusal scheme is developed to minimize anterior vertical overlap within the dictates of aesthetics and phonetics. It's developed to distribute the forces perpendicular to the residual ridge to equally distribute forces during mastication. This illustration shows the setup of monoplane occlusion with a balancing ramp. You can see that the occlusal plane is relatively parallel to the denture base, and all of the forces are distributed down the long axis of the teeth, distributing the load perpendicular to the base or the foundation. In protrusive, the teeth remain in contact, and again, the overall vector is to follow the occlusal ridge when exerting forces on it to preserve it. We're going to talk about bilateral balance with anatomic posterior teeth versus lingualized occlusion. If you look at the picture on the left, that is a semi-anatomical tooth about 15 to 20 degrees, and you'll notice that the buccal cusps are in contact as well as the lingual cusp. In lingualized occlusion shown on the right, the lingual cusp does the primary working, and when it does work in that central fossa of the lower teeth, it at no time allows the buccal cusp to come in contact with each other. When the patient goes into left working, on the balancing side, those denture bases are being pushed into the sides of the ridges as the teeth try to occlude against one another and work themselves to an end-to-end position. This slide shows the same scenario that we had in the previous one, only with lingualized occlusion versus full cross-arch balance. If you notice, on lingualized occlusion, the maxillary cusp is usually a high-degreed cusp, and the lower is either a flat plane or a very slight inclination like a 12-degree or a 10-degree tooth. The tooth setup is such that the lingual cusp is the only thing that occludes in that central fossa. The inner incline of the maxillary buccal cusp is out of occlusion and never comes into contact when the patient goes into that working or non-working movement. It just glides in that fossa. So theoretically, there should be less lateral displacement of denture and less lateral forces during function when using lingualized posterior denture occlusion compared to full anatomic occlusion. In lingualized occlusion, the lingual cusp tip should be in contact with the central fossa of the opposing mandibular teeth. The cuspal inclines of the mandibular teeth are kept relatively flat, resulting in potentially less lateral forces and displacement during function. When the tooth is in function, it will maintain a slight spacing between the maxillary buccal and the maxillary mandibular cusp. In lingualized occlusion, when the patient goes into working movement, the mandibular teeth and the maxillary buccal cusp should have a slight space between them. The lingual cusp, on the other hand, will be in contact with the tooth through a slight range of movement. On the balancing side, the lingual cusp should stay in contact with the inner inclines of the mandibular buccal cusp in movement. If you look at the articulating marks on the mandibular, you can see how the lingual cusp of the maxillary teeth ride in that fossa. On the maxillary arch, you can see that the only thing in contact is the lingual cusp of the maxillary tooth. Some of the indications for use of lingualized occlusion are, first of all, high aesthetic demands. If you have a young patient, the high cuspal inclination on the maxillary arch really improves the aesthetics considerably over the monoplane teeth, so you get good aesthetics with them. Also, if you have a severely atrophic mandibular ridge, it allows you to use another alternative and frees you from the use of a non-anatomic tooth on the patient. If you have displaceable supporting tissues like a flabby ridge, you still have that potential for bilateral balance without displacing the tissues as severely. If you have malocclusion, it centralizes the vertical forces down the long axis and right directly onto the crest of the ridge, and that is beneficial when you have malocclusion. Also, if a patient's had a previously successful denture with lingualized occlusion or some type of anatomic occlusion, it will allow you the use of something that is similar. It will minimize tipping forces and it facilitates bolus penetration compared to the flat plane. You kind of get that mortar and pestle effect that you would have with a pharmacy tool compared to just crushing food between two flat planes. We're showing here the position of the monoplane posterior teeth. The teeth are set over the crest of the ridge in an absolutely flat plane that parallels the denture foundation, and we usually use no balancing ramps on these. When the patient goes into protrusive, those anterior teeth should slide over one another. There should not be vertical overlap. When you do go into protrusive, though, you're going to find the next slide. When we use the monoplane occlusion, the nutricentric concept, meaning we have no balancing ramps in the posterior area, at balancing and protrusive positions, there's going to be a separation of the posterior teeth, and that leads to tipping of the dentures. This may be disadvantageous in the patients that exhibit parafunctional grinding habits because they will be going in those directions on a regular basis and probably will end up experiencing sore ridges with this type of an occlusal scheme. Some of the advantages to non-anatomic monoplane occlusion are the following. You have a reduction of horizontal forces. There's no cusp to interfere with any horizontal movement whatsoever. CR can be developed as an area instead of just a point. The point would be the lingualized occlusion, whereas an entire area is developed. You want as much of that flat plane tooth in contact as possible. You have freedom of movement. You can also develop solid occlusion despite arch alignment discrepancies because you really don't have any interferences with the positioning of the cusp. They're easily adapted to situations where the denture is prone to shifting, like flabby tissues or a totally atrophic ridge. Also, it's very easy to set these teeth yourself and to adjust them because we don't have to worry about bilateral balance. The disadvantages are that there's no vertical component to aid in shearing during mastication. That point is gone, and it's just board against board as far as trying to masticate the food. An occlusal adjustment impairs the efficiency of these teeth if they're flat plane, unless you create some new spillways and put some grooves and exits so that the food can escape from the surface. Also, the patients may complain of lack of positive intercuspation position. Some people like to be more locked in when they close their teeth into position. And also, they're definitely aesthetically limited. They don't look like natural teeth. Some brands are a little bit better as far as anatomy, but on the whole, they're not very aesthetic. What is interesting about looking at complete denture occlusion, investigators have not shown one type of denture occlusion to be superior in function, safer to the oral structures, or more acceptable to patients. If you look long enough and hard enough, you can find a study that goes both ways about occlusion. If you look at the illustration at the top of the slide, you will see that as far as picking your occlusal scheme and the denture teeth, the following applies. The larger ridge would allow for steep cuspal inclination, as is present on the anatomic teeth with cuspal inclinations of 30 and 20 degrees. The occlusal scheme would be set in a full cross-arch balance. As the ridge resorbs, then you may want to consider the semi-anatomic tooth, which has a cuspal inclination between 12 and 15 degrees, and it too would normally be set in full cross-arch balance. As more resorption takes place, then you may switch to lingualized occlusion using a steeper cusp on the maxillary arch and the flat plane or semi-anatomic tooth on the lower. This can be set with or without balance, and finally, with the extremely resorbed ridge, you would tend to use the monoplane tooth for your complete denture reconstruction. This too can be set with balance or a pure neutral centric occlusal scheme. Neuromuscular control may be the single most important factor in the successful manipulation of a complete denture under function. If the patient lacks good neuromuscular control, they will have a terrible time in adjusting to the denture and may not have a very successful experience. Tongue function is also important to denture wearing. If the tongue is very, very large, you have to be very careful with the placement of the mandibular teeth in order to control movement of that lower denture. In addition, the lingual flange of the denture should be long enough that it is not disturbed by the manipulation of the floor of the mouth, but at the same time have also a contour that is sort of concave so that the tongue can rest in a position that helps hold that denture down. A denture that is too short will be a problem because the tongue will have a tendency to get under the denture. You also have patients who position their tongues in the posterior when they're just resting instead of it positioning itself right behind the mandibular anteriors. All of this will affect the complete denture and the successful wear of that denture. An additional lecture on complete denture occlusion is available and is shown below. It is Hanau's Quint and probably should precede this lecture, but if you have not viewed it, you will probably enjoy it. The link is shown below.